have been discussing how the future of agriculture is likely to be in 2021. My paper is about to come out. I insisted that despite all of those, agriculture, as Fowler put it, will remain because of its centric role it has in the economy. In terms of food security, nutrition, export, and of course, agro industries. So because of that importance, agriculture will still remain. And if in the equation you remove COVID and the natural disasters, climate change, which didn't come out clearly in this presentation, then we shall remain with our traditional problems, which have come out very clearly in this paper regarding productivity. Productivity has been with us, it is with us, and it will remain with us until we address all the factors related to increase productivity and production. Agriculture, you cannot just dive in on one item and think you'll get it. We have all along, and I want to emphasize that we have to continue with the research because we need high-yielding crop varieties and high-yielding breeding animals. We need to emphasize research, both basic and applied. I was asked to relate this to policy, and I want to bring it right from the start, that with the policy, we introduce a policy either to cure a problem or to direct people, the population in a certain direction. And whenever you introduce a policy, make sure you have a clear institutional framework under which you are going to implement that policy. Thirdly, you need to ensure that you have sufficient staff, that is personnel, it is well funded, there's finance, in order to implement that policy. Short of that, however good the policy may sound, it cannot be implemented. So that is overall among issues I'm going to discuss. In my recent study, I found that we have more board members supervising less number of scientists in Uganda. If you take into NARO and all NARO as an organization, the council above it, then you take into the institutions, each institution, Namurunga, whatever others, they have different board members. And then what about the zones? They have also committee members or directors, whatever you may call them, but they're supervising less. We need to streamline that. If we don't do that, then the flow of the information will not reach the recipient, the farmers. So another area in this, agriculture will remain important still, though its contribution to GDP is declining. It is declining because it was almost 60 when I was still in school. Now it has come to almost about 24 because other opportunities are emerging. So our success in industries, our success in services is impacting on agriculture. But because of the high population we have, we need to feed these people. And agriculture has been growing at less than the population growth rate. So as long as we still have a high fertility rate at 5.4 and even more, as long as we have still population growth rate, the other one I was saying fertility rate, This one I'm saying population growth rate at 3, and agriculture remains at 2. Come 2030-40, we may not be able to feed our people. I have also examined that despite this COVID, there is one positive side about it, that because people, there was a shutdown, lecturers, teachers, and others, they all went into farming. Farming has now a middle class people coming in, and these can easily appreciate the services from research to adapt the innovations and the technologies, and also they can appreciate the services of advisory services and extension. However, they may not be permanent if we don't make agriculture profitable. We need to ensure that we add value for the benefit of the primary producer. But otherwise, if the price doesn't, if value addition does not reflect, is not reflected at grassroots level for the one to get a good price, still we are bound to suffer. However, the importance of agro-processing cannot be underestimated. Unfortunately, where we have managed to succeed, as this paper points out, there is low capacity. You hear there are no oranges to feed the fruit factory. You hear there are no tomatoes to feed the tomato production, processing. I think all of this go back to where I started, that in agriculture, you cannot dive in for one part. You need to have, as long as we are talking about the 10 crops for value chains, we need to ensure that we all go through along the whole value chain. Primary production, use of fertilizer, use of good soil, use of good seeds and good breeding animals, ensuring extension knowledge, adapting the technology and innovations, ensuring the water for production that is available. Many people submit that there is no, we want to irrigate. But if you go to irrigate where you have no input, manure or fertilizer, you are increasing the leaching. And therefore, you can't get benefit. When you talk of irrigation, make sure you have also manure or fertilizers. These are policy issues, but need institutional framework to be implemented and properly coordinated all through. Then when you have you are producing, we need the concentrated areas in order to ease marketing. Because you can't have one load several kilometers away and you think it is cost effective for one to collect a few tons from that area. So we need to have these concentrated zones of production in order to ease marketing. And in that way, we can supply the factories. So the issue of low processing capacity has two sides, that where we have the plants, we don't have enough to improve. For some of you who have bothered to go into the industry in processing at any level, you must know the cost in terms of electricity, the tariffs. I have been part of this process to ensure that we improve on the infrastructure. We improve on the infrastructure in terms of roads, in terms of railway line, even airline, and production of generating of electricity. The idea behind is that we reduce the cost of production in order to make agro-processing attractive and attract more people there. But as of now, we have capacity, excess capacity in electricity, but the tariffs are so high. And you have heard the president now and then referring to it. Until this is solved, this is also a big constraint in terms of agro processing. The role of the government has come out clearly here. Yes, there must be budgetary support. There must be budgetary support, but we should ensure budgetary support in those areas which are of a public undertaking and create enabling environment for the private sector to take their role as long as it is profitable. The private sector is bound to do more and more. We have a lot of funds in Act Credit. Incidentally, much as I'm a chancellor of Ndege University, I'm also the chairman of Micro Support Center. Funds are there, but you find that people who would go to Uganda Development Bank, they come to Micro Support Center. There should be about four sources of money. One, the micro, which I'm charge of. Then there could be development, insurance, and like things like social security fund. But in all these other areas, there are no funds. People run away from UDB to come to microfinance. And instead going for the poor, I at times find myself addressing those who would go into SMEs, who would have gone to the front back. These are policy issues. So I think the what we can learn from this presentation regarding increasing productivity and production, institutional arrangement, enhancing processing through the value chain which are adopted, I think we need to ensure coordination and address through. The issue of statistics remains the challenge because ever since we did away with the chieftainship, I mean the chiefs, the chieftainship, which was responsive to collecting data in terms of deaths and the people are born and collect the data reliably, and we went to elective councils like LOCs, we lost almost a free source of collecting accurate data. And since then, it is a struggle. Because when you put the institutions and you don't finance them properly, still you don't get the results. A good example is on land tenure, which came up to here. They talked about land reform. I remember we created a land tenure system where we have land committees, tribal committees. But this committee has never been utilized because they have never been budgeted before. This goes back to where I started, that when you are introducing a policy, make sure it has institutional framework, and then it has a budget and personnel. But underlying it, it must have a legal framework. In some cases, it needs a legal framework because policies are also a part of a legal system. So I want to congratulate Mr. Fowler and Jacobo for the good presentation. And I want to congratulate Makere University College of Agriculture and Environment, Environmental Science, for causing this debate.